Sabbath and Happy New Year. It's the first Sabbath of the new year. We're so glad to get to be with you. Did you guys have fun in the snow? Our family enjoyed doing some sledding and we had fun with our dog out on the trail because she loves to be in the snow. So we're going to sing some songs together. Why don't you join us in worship?
We're going to sing Here I Am to Worship.
In kindergarten Sabbath school, we have been learning the sign language to this. So if you know sign language, you guys sing it along. And if you don't, just use your voices and maybe you can learn the sign language. We're going to go a little slow to help me remember. I did a little mess up on the sign language, so see if you caught it. Okay. Okay, we're going to sing Kids Under Construction.
Kids Under Construction. Maybe the paint is still wet. Kids Under Construction.
My God is so big.
My God is so big, so strong and so mighty. There's nothing my God cannot do. My God is so big, so strong and so mighty. There's nothing my God cannot do. He made the trees, he made all the seas, he made the elephant too. My God is so big, so strong and so mighty. My God is so great, so strong and so mighty. There's nothing my God cannot do. My God is so great, so strong and so mighty. There's nothing my God cannot do. The mountains are His, the rivers are His, the stars are His handiwork too. My God is so great, so strong and so mighty. There's nothing my God cannot do for you.
Made me glad.
I will enter his gates with thanksgiving.
sing the butterfly song.
If I were a butterfly, I thank you, Lord, for giving me wings. And if I were a robin in a tree, I thank you, Lord, that I could sing. And if I were a fish in the sea, I'd wiggle my tail and I'd giggle with glee. But I just thank you, Violet, for making me be. For you gave me a heart and you gave me a smile. You gave me Jesus and you gave me your child. And I just thank you, Father, for making me me. If I were an elephant, I'd thank you, Lord, for raising my trunk. And if I were a kangaroo, I know I'd hop right up to you. And if I were a fuzzy wuzzy bear, I thank you, Lord, for my fuzzy wuzzy hair. But I just thank you, Father, for making me me. For you gave me a heart and you gave me a smile. You gave me Jesus and you gave me a child. And I just thank you, Father, for making me me.
Good morning, boys and girls. Happy Sabbath. I am so excited to be here with you for another Nature Nugget. And this week's Nature Nugget is extremely exciting, and I can't wait to share with you. And when I was studying about this animal, I learned so much fun and interesting facts. And especially the best message of all that I learned from this animal is that God loves me and you so very much. So let's go over the clues and see if you can guess what this week's Nature Nugget animal is. Clue number one. This animal was able to easily adapt to the life in human settlements due to the constant supply of food. And clue number two. Even though this bird is not considered a water bird, they are extremely good swimmers when they are needing to get away from predators. All right, let's think about it. What animal helps us to learn how much God loves me and you, and they are good swimmers? That's right. This week's Nature Nugget animal is all about the sparrow. So let's jump in and learn some fun things about this bird. Sparrows are small birds. There are about 35 species of sparrows just in North America, but they are also found all over the world. Scientists estimate that there are about 140 species worldwide. They may be small, but don't underestimate them. Sparrows are identified by their small size, but also many other interesting characteristics. They are only about 6 inches long. That's half the size of a standard ruler. Different types of sparrows can be slightly larger or slightly smaller. About 6 inches is the average. Even though they are small, sparrows have giant feet. Well, we wonder why they have such large feet. These birds use those big old feet to scratch the ground in search of seeds to eat. Their cone-shaped beaks help them to peck at seeds. Although they are mostly a plain brown color, that doesn't mean they don't stand out. Sparrows have beautiful voices, and their chirping and singing can be heard all over. Another unique characteristic are their smooth, round heads and rounded wings. Males have reddish feathers on their backs, and females are brown and striped. Some of the many species of sparrows include the song sparrow, the vesper sparrow, fox sparrow, and the white-crowned sparrow. These different types live in different areas, from the swampy marshes to the forest areas to deserts. They can live pretty much anywhere and have a variety of habitats. These habitats, or natural living environments, can be found all over the world. All sparrows mainly eat seeds, but they also eat insects, moss, berries, and fruits when available. They feed insects to their young babies to help them grow up strong.
When it comes to the construction, these birds are very efficient. They build their nests low to the ground and make them of grass, twigs, and smaller plants. The nests are small but very well built. Once the nest is complete, the female lays 4 to 5 small white eggs. It only takes less than 2 weeks for the babies to hatch. God made sparrows with a beautiful ability to make beautiful songs to worship and glorify Him. Let's take a minute and listen to some songs that sparrows like to sing. Wow, what did you think? I thought they were beautiful. I just love their ability to sing. They sound so pretty, don't they? I always thought that the sparrow was one of the most common birds in the world. You could count on them being in every garden. However, something terrible happened in the 1990s. Year after year, there were fewer and fewer sparrows in Britain, until there were hardly any at all. In some areas of Britain, their numbers had fallen by 99%. That's most of them. I'm sure everyone over there in Britain missed seeing all of the beautiful sparrows. Ornithologists, which are people who study birds, don't know the real reason for their disappearance. Some think it may be to the pollution from cars, and others think it may be the mobile phone mast. Some say the pesticides the farmers use to spray their crops wipe them out, because sparrows eat lots of insects. Others say the rise in the number of cats people keep as pets is maybe part of the reason. Cats are the sparrow's number one predator. We still do not know the reason for their huge decline. So let's remember in Matthew 10:29, "Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground outside your Father's care." Matthew 10:29. What a beautiful Bible verse, and helps us to remember that God cares for even the sparrows, and He notes when each one of them is ill. Sometimes we think we are nothing special, just an ordinary person like a common sparrow. But God knows everything about us, and He loves us so very much. When I was little, we used to sing this song called "God Sees the Little Sparrow Fall." Let's sing it together, okay? Very good. You guys sounded beautiful. And never forget that God loves you so very much. Remember, like the beautiful book Steps to Christ talks about, we can learn more about Jesus in nature. The green fields, the trees, the passing clouds, all of it speaks to our hearts and invites us to become acquainted with Jesus who made them all, including the beautiful singing sparrow. All right, boys and girls, here are your clues for next week's Nature Nugget animal. Clue number one, they have eyes in the back of their heads. And clue number two, they like it hot. All right, good luck, and I hope you guys have a wonderful week. And I can't wait to join you again next week for another Nature Nugget. Bye!
Hi, it's a week after Christmas, but I don't think it's too late to tell one more Christmas story. So, and part of the Christmas story is about how Mary and Joseph had no room in the inn, so they had to sleep in a stable. I've heard that many times, but it never really made a big impression on me. Until this summer, our family took a trip to Yellowstone National Park. And in Yellowstone, there's 12 campgrounds for people to stay at. We like to sleep in tents, and there's 12 big campgrounds for people to stay. But five of them allow you to reserve early, and the other seven, you have to show up and ask for a campsite. So we got on the computer, and my daughter did a lot of work, and she found campsites for all of it except for 2 days. We're going to stay there for a week, but we couldn't find a campsite for Tuesday and Wednesday. But we thought, that's in the middle of the week. And there's 7 campgrounds that allow first come, first served. And most people would camp on a weekend. So we'll go out there and we'll see what we can find. And that's what we did. So we went out and we got to Yellowstone and we found out, oh no, the 7 campgrounds that are first come, first served, they're all closed because of COVID. So we wouldn't be able to stay there. But still, the 5, they said occasionally they have cancellations. So check with them first thing in the morning on Tuesday morning and see if we could find a site for Tuesday night and Wednesday night. So we were a little worried about that, but we said, okay, we'll try it. Well, we had a lot of fun on Sunday and Monday, and Tuesday morning we got up really early. We went to the office of the campground and he said, I'm sorry, there's no room. And he checked on his computer. There's no room in any of the campsites. Any of our 5 campgrounds are all full tonight. You're not going to be able to stay here. Oh no, what should we do? Well, he gave us a list. There's some campgrounds that are outside of the park. We'd have to leave the park and then come back in, but they're really close to the edge. So we thought we would try that. And so we went and started searching. And we looked at one campsite and it was just for RVs. You can't stay in a tent there. And when we looked at hotels, and they were so expensive, we just couldn't. The hotels there were just outrageously. We couldn't afford to stay there. And then we found there's a national campground that's just up the road a little bit. And so we started driving on this road and went from a paved road to a 2-lane road to 1-lane road to a dirt road. And we finally found this campground. Big sign, no room. What are we going to do? Well, my daughter who found the other campsite, she got on her computer and was checking, and she found out there is another campsite. And should we make a reservation? And so we did. And we made a reservation, and they had room for the 2 nights. And so we said, well, where's the address to go to? And so we went and found that address, and we drove down the road, and it's a little building there. And on the door, there was a big sign saying, closed, closed by the order of the county. And, oh no, what could we do there? It's closed. And we have ordered this site online. But then we looked down at the bottom in small print. There was this, if you've reserved a campsite, the campsites are actually a mile down the road, a little bit further. So we got back in the car and drove down another mile down the road. And we found that there was a site there. And there was camping there, even though the place had been a nice hotel at one time. And years and years ago, it had burned down, and there was still like an abandoned swimming pool there, but they had built in another section a nice bathhouse, and they had running water, good running water, and then good bathrooms and hot showers, which is very nice when you're camping, and then really good campgrounds that were nice and level. So we ended up finding some room, just like Mary and Joseph did, but it was very interesting, or it was very exciting how much work we had to do to try to find a campsite that day. And we praised God that we found a nice place to stay. And we always want you to have room in your heart for Jesus. Right now, he doesn't need a campsite and he doesn't need a stable. But he wants to have some room in your heart this year and every year.
The Bible tells me so.
Rishon and his family were moving from the big city to a small house on a mountainside in India. Rishon had many toys, and his mom and dad needed to talk with him about getting rid of some of them. "You don't need all these big toys," his dad said. "You are going to be very busy doing things other than playing with them." His mom talked about the children living in the village near the new house. "The village children are poor and don't have nice toys like you," she said. "Why don't you give them your big toys?" Rishon was an obedient boy, and he didn't mind giving away his big toys. He gave them to the boys and girls in the village, who were very excited to receive the gifts. They had never owned such nice toys before. Rishon was happy to see their joy, and it felt so good to do something kind for others. As the days passed, Rishon saw that his mom and dad were right. He was very busy. He went to school at home, with his mom teaching him English, Hindi, and other languages, and his dad teaching him math and science. When Rishon wasn't studying, he worked in the family garden, planting, weeding, and harvesting corn, potatoes, and other crops. Every day he memorized 3 verses from the Bible. After a few months, he could recite many chapters by memory, including Psalm 23 and Hebrews 11. Rishon didn't have much time to play, even with his small toys, so he also gave them away to the village children. The children, especially the little ones, quickly became Rishon's friends. At first, they liked him because he gave them toys, but then they got to know him, and they saw that he was a kind, gentle boy. They liked to visit Rishon at his house on the mountainside. Rishon liked to play with the children. Sometimes they played with Rishon's old toys, but most of the time, they played church. You see, the children weren't Christians, and their parents weren't Christians. They didn't know anything about God creating the world, or Jesus dying for people's sins. They didn't know anything about praying to God. But by playing church, Rishon taught the children about Jesus. They sat on the dusty ground as Rishon told them stories about Adam and Eve, Noah's Ark, David and Goliath, and Daniel in the lion's den. He told them about Jesus dying on the cross to give eternal life to everyone who believes in him. He invited them to pray to Jesus and showed them how. "Dear God," he said, "thank you for being our very best friend. Please give us a heart of love for you and for others. In Jesus' name, amen." The other children began to copy Rishon's prayers, and they told their parents about the Bible stories. Then some of the parents even asked Rishon's parents to know more about Jesus. Now Rishon doesn't have much time to play with his remaining toys. He is too busy being a missionary for Jesus.
My God's the king of the giants. My God's the king of the lions. My God's the king of the creatures of the deep. My God's the king of me.
Have you heard the story about my friend King Dave? Wouldn't let the giant stand in his way. He said, "Hand me my sling, 'cause he's not that tall. My God is bigger and I'll watch him fall.
My God's the King of the Giants. My God's the King of the Lions. My God's the King of the creatures of the deep. My God's the King of me. Have you heard the one about this guy called Dan? Yes, he was a mighty holy praying man. They said, throw him to the den of the scary beast. But God saved a hero from the lion's teeth. Yeah! My God's the King of the Giants. My God's the King of the Lions. My God's the King of the creatures of the deep. My God's the King of me. History, you will do the same for me, like Jonah and the whale at sea. When I'm lost and afraid, all alone in the dark, you're with me. Oh, you're with me. My God's the King of the Giants. My God's the King of the Lions. My God's the King of the creatures of the deep. My God's the King of me. My God's the King of the Giants. My God's the King of the Lions. My God's the King of the creatures of the deep. My God's the King of me. My God's the King of me.
Of the Bible. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges, Ruth, 1st and 2nd Samuel, 1st Kings, 2nd Kings, 1st and 7th Chronicles, Ezra, Nehemiah, Esther, Job, Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Samuel, Solomon, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Lamentations, Ezekiel, Daniel, Hosea, Joel, Obadiah, Jonah, Micah, Nahum, Habakkuk, Zephaniah, Haggai, Zechariah, and the last one, Malachi.
Hello, boys and girls. This is Aunt Fernita, and I have a wonderful story for you called A Child Like Me. Today's memory verse is from Luke chapter 2, verse 51. It says, "Then he went down to Nazareth and was obedient." The message for today's story is we are like Jesus when we obey and help. How do you show someone you love them? Do you give them lots of hugs? Are you kind to them? Do you give them presents? Do you do what they ask of you? Jesus was little, just like you. He didn't go to nursery school. He stayed home with his mother Mary. Every day, she taught him about God. She told him stories about Adam and Eve, Noah and the ark, David and Goliath. She taught him how to pray, "Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for loving me. Amen." Mary, his mother, taught Jesus songs about God like the ones you learn in Sabbath school. Jesus and Mary often went for nature walks. They listened to the birds sing. They watched beetles climb over logs and spiders spin their webs. They studied the dew on the grass. They watched the animals play. They looked at the changing colors of the sky as the sun set. As they watched all of this, Mary told Jesus that God had made the world and everything in it. Jesus' family lived in a small house, but it was clean.
Jesus helped his mother around the house. He helped set the table for dinner. He helped dry the dishes. He made his bed. He helped Mary make bread. Whatever his mother asked him to do, Jesus did it cheerfully. Jesus helped his father take care of the animals. He fed them and he gave them water. He helped Joseph fix things too. When Jesus was older, he helped Joseph in his carpenter shop. Jesus was kind to neighbors and their children. He was helpful when he saw that someone had a need, such as helping the grandmother carry her heavy, heavy load of firewood, or making a sad child laugh. Jesus had time to play, too. The other boys in his neighborhood liked to play with him. When it was time to come in and his mother called him, Jesus came quickly. Every Friday evening, Jesus' family ate a special meal to welcome the Sabbath. Jesus helped light the Sabbath candles for their meal. Then he listened carefully as Joseph prayed and talked about God. On Sabbath, Mary and Joseph took Jesus to church. There he heard the priest read from the books of the Bible. In those days, the Bible was written on scrolls. A scroll is a rolled-up piece of paper with words written on it. Jesus listened carefully to the words from the scroll. He learned the words and could recite them from memory. Jesus sang songs while he worked, and people were glad to pass by his house because he was always singing. He made them feel happy. But most of all, Jesus made his family happy by obeying and being helpful.
This podcast is produced by Gracelink.net at Studio El Piso, Singapore. For more children's resources, please visit Gracelink.net.
Thank you so much for joining us this morning. We're glad that you could be here with us. thanks for sending in your talents. We have some talents, obviously, here. Did any of you send in snow pictures? I'm hoping so. All right, let's pray together. God, thank you so much for this day. Thank you for the gift of Sabbath. Thank you so much for getting to sing praises to you. Thank you for your word, where we can learn about you. Thank you for the beautiful snow that you sent. Thank you for the animals that are fun to watch in the snow. Thank you for a new year that we know you have been with us in this past year and that you will be with us in the year to come. Thank you for your faithfulness and your goodness and your love. We sure love you, Jesus. Amen. I hope you have a good week. Bye-bye.